Well, let's begin with the House Committee on Agriculture and Food's findings on alleged agricultural hoarding issue. You've announced your findings a few days ago, the other day, particularly against an alleged cartel. Walk us through your findings. What did you find out? How responsible is this company and the people behind it for the surge in prices of onions?
Yes, Mike, after 9 hearings, we believe we found sufficient evidence to show that the group of Lea Cruz, so it's Lea Cruz and related entities, including Yom Trading, Larina, Tianlong Cold Storage, Vegafruit Producing Store, and possibly Super 5 Cold Storage. So in short, a group of companies called Phil Vieva Group of Companies is operating as the onion cartel and could be behind the surge of onion prices in 2022. So that's the main conclusion of 9 hearings.
Do we know, Congresswoman, how long this company and the so-called Sibuyas Queen have been operating? And can we quantify the extent to which the prices of onions have been manipulated?
So this corporation, Phil Vieva, was established in 2013. And this was established shortly after news reports started to come out in the early, I believe, 2012. Soon as those stories started to float, this corporation, which put together, it's vertically integrated. So it has trucking, it has local trading, it has importers, it has cold storage. So it's fully integrated. It also has farming. So we believe it was the way for Lea Cruz to continue doing her onion business, but through dummies. So that's basically the theory. So while she kept telling us during the initial part of the hearings, in fact, throughout the 9 hearings, she kept denying her involvement in the onion industry, saying that I no longer import onions, etc. My name is being dragged into this and I'm being unfairly treated because I no longer import onions. But it would seem, based on documents, that she continues to be involved in this industry in a very major way through this group of companies.
How does this work, Congresswoman? I mean, you mentioned even from the start, farming up to importation, even up to trucking. So how does that work? I mean, these are several companies supposedly working together to control the price, but how does that happen?
So it begins with importation. So they control basically most of the import permits. So in 2022 alone, for example, for yellow onions, three of the Lea Cruz companies, Yom Trading, Larina, and Vegafruit, already controlled 70% of yellow imported yellow onions. Right? So they control first imports. And when you do that, you're actually able to use that as bargaining leverage against farmers. So you can say, you know, if you know, my imported onions are so cheap, you'd better sell those to me cheap because wala yung pupuntahan, for example, right? So, and in addition, our farmers don't have cold storages, right? So because this company also owns the cold storage, they can also tell the farmers, wala nang space dito sa ating cold storage. So benta yan sa amin at a low price, wala mapupuntahan ang inyong produce. So you might as well sell that to us. So owning the cold storage and having a bulk of your imports means a lot in terms of bargaining leverage at the farm gate.
So and because they have the supply of onions, they can also control the release of onions into the market?
Yeah, so basically by having a control of the imported onions as well as the local produce, then, and you have every all of those in your own cold storages. And in addition, you have logistics, meaning you have your trucking business. Then because of mm-hmm. that, it's easy for you to coordinate the releases mm-hmm. to the various retail outlets. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of the simplistic way to explain how you can easily control prices.
Mm-hmm. We'll of course try to get the side of Slea Cruz and Villalvieva, but they were given a chance, right, Congresswoman, during the hearing to address these allegations.
There were 9 hearings. Mm-hmm. They were, of course, in some of those, they provided excuses for why they were not there. Mm. Sometimes they were ill. But yes, in every one of those 9 hearings, they were supposed to be there.
Mm. You said, Congresswoman, there is enough evidence to go after them. Will they be charged? Will they be prosecuted?
So that's, I don't want to preempt the committee report, but mm-hmm. most likely than not, that is going to be one of the recommendations to file cases before the Philippine Competition Commission, which has primary jurisdiction over cartel mm-hmm. cases. Of course, this is probably, there could be multiple cases, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But for the cartel case, my understanding of the Philippine Competition Act mm-hmm. Indicates that for the cartel case, that will go before the Philippine Competition Commission.
Aside from that, Representative, do we have enough laws to go after hoarders or price manipulators? Because we had Agriculture Deputy Spokesperson, Assistant Secretary Rex Estuperez on Teleradio on Tuesday saying, what would be the basis to raid warehouses storing onions? He's saying that they can't be accused of hoarding because they are actually selling onions to the market, albeit that it's a controlled release of the onions. He said they don't have the authority to go after them. Is that right, Representative? Can't the Agriculture Department actually go after those who are alleged to be manipulating the prices of onions and other agricultural products?
I'm not sure about the DA's authority, mm-hmm. but as to the government as a whole, mm-hmm. not having authority, I will disagree with that. Because again, under the Philippine Competition Act, the PCC, I believe, has sufficient powers. PCC is pretty new, so maybe not a lot of people know that they have sufficient powers. So, mm-hmm. so for example, in the case of hoarding, that falls squarely within the jurisdiction of the PCC. So that's and there are very stiff penalties under the Philippine Competition Act. For example, for the first offense, fines can go up to 100 million pesos, and the imprisonment can go up to 7 years. So, and this is for a cartel offense. So this would include. The wording is limiting or controlling production. So maybe, and that includes hoarding. So maybe people are just used to the word hoarding and will not think that it is the same as limiting or controlling production, but that falls under limiting or controlling production. So there's probably in my mind, with due respect to other legislators, there's probably no need to draft more laws with respect to hoarding, because there is an existing law on that.
So is this a question, a representative, of the PCC enforcing that law?
Yes.
Or can the DA actually also enforce that particular law, saying it's within their jurisdiction?
So through the PCC, all they need to do is have a MOA with the PCC and have the PCC enforce against the smugglers. So that's the way it should be done. So I know it because I used to be with the PCC, mm-hmm. and we used to do it this way. We used to sign MOAs with other agencies so that we could do the enforcement for them. I don't know how PCC is doing it today. I believe it should be the same way. Mm-hmm. But again, maybe because of the newness of this agency that not a lot of people know, but I think it's really just an implementation issue. So if we can give PCC a chance to prove that they can do it this way, maybe maybe we don't need to craft a new law at this point.
Interesting you said that, the representative, because of course the Senate is looking at amending the Anti-Agricultural Smuggling Act, and they're looking at, for instance, considering hoarding and profiteering as economic sabotage if it reaches a certain threshold. Because under the current Anti-Agricultural Smuggling Act, it's only smuggling of over 1 million pesos worth of agriculture products that's considered economic sabotage. But with respect to hoarding and profiteering, they also want to impose that same kind of penalty. What are your thoughts about this? I mean, you said earlier, we don't need to craft new laws.
So, okay, there are two kinds, right? So the hoarding that I was talking about earlier, that has to do with hoarding done among competitors, right? Mm-hmm. But and that's under the Philippine Competition Act. And I think that's sufficiently addressed. But if it's hoarding that's done unilaterally, I believe that's covered under the Price Act. So that's already an existing law. So, but whether they believe that the penalty, and that's being enforced by the DDI. So if they believe that the penalty under that is too small, then maybe that can be amended. But with respect to the Philippine Competition Act, I think that the penalty is high enough. Like $2 billion for the first offense, and then for the second offense, $250 million. I have not seen any other law with penalties higher than that. So, so I think that's the biggest penalty that I've seen so far. So with respect to anti-competitive agreements for hoarding, I think that's covered. For unilateral kind of hoarding, perhaps that's where laws can be amended or crafted.
Mm-hmm. Talk about the penalties, Congresswoman, because you just heard Senator Robin Padilla wanting to impose death penalty on uniformed personnel, government officials who will engage in smuggling or other forms of profiteering. Of course, we don't have a death penalty law at the moment, but would you be in favor if there's a return of the death penalty? Would you be in favor of including these particular offenses as punishable by death penalty?
Well, agricultural smuggling is clearly a serious crime. So I'm with him on that. But with respect to death penalty, I'm not too sure. I mean, that's something that clearly on my part needs to be studied. There are many issues with respect to that.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, all of these, Congresswoman, what's the role of the Bureau of Customs? How important is it? Because they were grilled yesterday about their performance. What are your thoughts about how the Bureau of Customs is performing with respect to agricultural smuggling?
Well, the fact that it continues to be there, and I'm not too happy in a nutshell.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, I mean, my conclusion, I have not come across a lot of as much documentary evidence as perhaps the cartel fury that we're pursuing. But parang ang lumalabas dito sa Onion Cartel is kung sino yung nag-import legitimately. Baka yun din yung nagsasmuggle.
Interesting. What can be done at this point? What else, Representative? Because you did mention about the lack of cold storage of farmers. That's why they had to rely on private companies offering this. But this is, I think, one of the campaign promises of President Marcos. In fact, in January, he said he wants more cold chain facilities for onion farmers to help prolong the shelf life of these products. Do you think that will be a solution? The government entering to the picture, competing with the private companies, how will that help the farmers?
Well, yes, definitely increasing cold storage will make the market more competitive. I mean, that's essentially what we're doing. The existence of a cartel makes the market less competitive. It's as simple as that. You have a cartel, that means your market forces don't work. The cartel will set the price. Instead of making the market forces work and making the prices market determined, meaning determined by demand and supply, it's now going to be determined by a single company. In this case, for example, Philbiaba, right? So we don't want that happening, right? So if have cold storages, then you many cold storages, then you don't have farmers being held up at the farm gate, right? They can now freely put in their produce because those facilities are freely available, right? That's one. Number two, loosen up regulations with respect to importation. So right now, the import permits are being issued to select firms. Nagkakapilian kung sino ang magiging importer. So in this case, as I said earlier, for some reason, they end up in the hands of this Phil Vieva group of companies, right? So I don't know why, but so that's part of this cartel hearing. Why do the import permits fall in the hands of this so-called onion cartel, right? Mm-hmm. So instead of having that kind of a system, so long as a country is allowed to export to the Philippines, dapat dyan, any registered company in the Philippines can bring in imports from that company, right? In mm-hmm. other words, wala na dapat permit ang ini-issue ng DA. Dapat yung usual na lang na permits from customs. Something mm-hmm. like that, right? And use tariff rates instead to protect our farmers. So in other words, maybe a kind of approach that we've taken for rice. Something like that. Maybe to improve upon it because maybe there's some issues in implementation. We've learned from rice anyway. So whatever lessons that we've learned from rice tariffication, perhaps learn from that.
And one of the options that the government is doing right now is through Kadiwa stores, selling cheaper onions and other agriculture products to Kadiwa stores. Is that a wise move, though? Because essentially, it's the government subsidizing the prices of onions. We buy it, the government buys it at a higher price, they sell it at a lower price, and then it's the government paying for it.
Well, but the problem there is when government buys, they also buy at the high price that this cartel dictates, right? So it still doesn't really solve the problem. You need to eliminate this cartel. As long as the cartel exists, the price will continue to be high, right? So that was what happened last year. So even when government stepped in, which was really good, the price went down a bit, but not tremendously low, right? So pwede pa sana bumaba, kaya lang, nandun pa rin yung cartel. Hindi pa rin bumaba ng as much as we wanted it to be. Pero bumaba, definitely bumaba. But pwede pa sana bumaba, kaya lang, meron pa rin the cartel continue to exist, right? So, and at the same time, kulang pa rin yung cold storage. So even if at the extreme that, you know, you have government talagang really already purchasing directly from the farmer, eliminating talaga all the traders, pumupunta na talaga sa bawat farm and will go directly to the retail outlet. Ang problema naman, kulang ang cold storage.
Plenty of problems there.
Yes. So at the end of the day, if you ask me, short term, allow imports in a way that I described earlier, right? Protect the farmers by using the tariff rates and then at same time returning the tariff revenues to them, just like the competition as the competitiveness enhancement fund that we used for rice. And then longer run, eliminate the cartel.
We hope that happens soon. And we will be looking forward to that committee report, Representative Stella Kimbo. Thank you so much.
Thank you.